everybody. Welcome to episode number 203 of the SoxProspects.com podcast. As you know, we are the web's number one source for information on the Boston Red Sox farm system from Fort Myers to Worcester and up the pike to Fenway and all stops in between. Thank you for listening. My name is Chris Hatfield. I'm the executive editor of SoxProspects.com, and I'm joined, as always, by our director of scouting, Ian Kundel. Ian, neither of us is in Fort Myers. Our guest today is...
Yes,
and I'm very jealous.
Very jealous because it's snowing here.
Yeah,
I think you were shoveling earlier. It's snowing here. Yeah,
literally ran in from shoveling to do this interview.
But you know what? I will say it's just nice that things are starting to get ramped up. We have minor league schedules now. You know, I was looking at it, like thinking, like, is there a game that I'm going to be able to go to at some point in the next couple of months? Like, so.
Yeah, very few for me. The Sea Dogs are not coming to Bowie, which is the closest park to me, and I am not thrilled about it.
I think that's just because of the pandemic. They said that they're only playing, like, the regional teams in their division. So, like, Pawtucket's only playing the northeast-ish teams, and, like,
Yeah, I mean, Greenville goes to Aberdeen once, and Aberdeen's not even that close. Aberdeen's, like, an hour and a half. Like, I'm not thrilled about it. And that's, like, the last series of the year, too. It's, like, mid-September. But whatever. It is what it is. We're going to have baseball soon. And we're burying the lead here, Ian. We've got Eddie Romero on the show today. Red Sox.
We do.
What is it? Executive vice president and assistant general manager. A man who's been with the club since, gosh, what is it, 2006? Mm-hmm. Has run the international scouting program for them since 2012. We've talked about all kinds of things with him. We think you're going to love this interview. We don't want to take too long before we get to it because it's so good. It's his 2020 was his 15th year in the organization, so he's going on his 16th. Future GM candidate, no question in my mind.
No question. I will be stunned if it's not within the next 3 years.
All right. I see that. I see that. That's bold to throw years on it, but I see that. And I mean, he assists in all areas of baseball ops. We wanted to talk to him a little bit about the other things he's doing now, but we just had so much to ask him about with the international program that we couldn't get to it. So next time,
exactly, we
will get to that. You know, he's got some great stories about Darwinson Hernandez, Brian Mata, Gilberto Jimenez.
You're burying the lead, Rafael Devers.
Devers, yeah.
Born to be a Red Sox, it turned out.
Born to be a Red Sox. Yeah, that's true. I mean, we talked about Daniel Flores. If you don't know who we're talking about, you'll learn a little bit about Daniel Flores, a player who the Red Sox gave $3.1 million and unfortunately passed away before he had the chance to play in the organization, and who, if you, at the time, followed anyone on social media who knew him, it was just crushing. When that happened. So he talks a little bit about Daniel Flores, gives us the scouting reports on players who are in the system right now.
That's great.
The current side, the current crop of guys they just signed, like I say in the interview, I love just winding him up and letting him go because I learn about the players in the system.
We're very
so
good
much.
At asking. We ask leading questions for a reason. Like there was one where he's like, "Oh, you set me up for that one." It's like, yeah, that was deliberate.
basically. So I'm like, it's, leading questions and the open-ended ones too. He makes a reference to the deposition thing I had to do recently, and because I mentioned it to him as a former lawyer, and now that I'm thinking about it, it's the same thing. So we deposed Eddie Romero, and it went great. Is the moral of the story. And we love the fact that he said some great things about us, and he's helped us a lot over the years with support. And some people who support us right now are supporters on patreon.com/SoxProspects. If you want to help support the show, you can go on there, pledge a certain amount per episode. And as always, we want to shout out our $5 level Patreon supporters. An ever-growing list, Ian, with two new members. That includes Kyle Costigan, Tyler Woodrall, Jeff Traynor, David Nardone, Tim Harding, Bill Stanton, Deb Kendall, Evan Kirkwood, Hurricanes 1, Chris Fox, James O'Hara, Nathan Kenyon, Andrew Wallen, David B., Ben Burnett, Al Mendel, Kevin Catrides, Ben NRI, Paul Denyer, Lendl Martin, Cassandra Buchta, James P. McMahon, Stephen Gregory, James Bailey, Andreas Golstrand, Corey Perrick, Forrest Perkins, Mark Herman, Aaron Mehta, and our newest members of the list, Jeff Harwood, and get this one, you're going to love this, Ian, Jimmy Mountain. Love your name, sir. I hope it's real. I don't know if it is. But you're always going to be Jimmy Mountain to me, whether or not you like me calling you by your full name. And of course, as always, send your emails to podcast@soxprospects.com. Ian, I honestly don't know if we can get to those today. There are a bunch.
Yeah, we might need to push those.
Let's do this. Everyone listening, our next episode, unless there's another like ridiculous thing that's happened, because last time, obviously, we had to hop on real quick for the Benintendi trade. Unless something happens that needs to take up most of the show, it will be a email-centric episode. Get in your emails to podcast@soxprospects.com. Don't think it's too silly a question. Don't think it's too in the weeds of a question. Don't think it's too specific. Don't think it's too long ago if you want to ask about someone who's not in the system anymore. Next episode, email spectacular. Help us out. We want to fill a show with just your emails. So get them in, okay? Because we've got like, what is it, 50 minutes of Eddie, and we've got a couple things we need to talk about on the show, Ian. So let's jump into it. Podcast@soxprospects.com. Ian, where should we start? I guess the biggest thing, obviously, happened yesterday.
They made another trade.
For another prospect. The Red Sox sent Chris Mazza and Jeffrey Springs, who had both been designated for assignment, to the Tampa Bay Rays for catching prospect Ronaldo Hernandez and infielder Nick Sogard, who is the brother of Eric.
Cousin.
Oh, they're only cousins?
Yes.
I need to edit his scouting report.
I put cousin in there. So unless you changed it, then it should be correct.
They're just cousins. No kidding.
He's also
cousin.
The
it does say cousin. Shows you how close I was looking at it.
He's also the nephew of Steve Sachs and some other. What's
Steve Sachs' brother.
Yes, his brother, who I don't know his name.
I've never heard of. I didn't know there was another Sachs, but Dave Sachs.
I don't know. Yeah.
But at any rate, yeah. Anyway, Hernandez is the headliner here, Ian. Enters the rankings at 14th in our Sox prospects rankings.
Controversial ranking, it turns out. Got way more feedback about his ranking than I think any player we've ever gotten on Twitter.
Well, we can talk about why, too, but maybe just the brief scouting report. People can go to the player page and see the scouting report, the full thing, Ian. But
there will also, by the time this is up, there will be an article with the scouting reports also. So if you don't want to go to the player page, you can go to the news page, too.
If for some reason that's better for you, which it's the same number.
I don't know why, but sure. I like it.
Go to both. See if they match.
Exactly. But yeah, Hernandez, it was really interesting because he was actually really highly regarded. He was someone who was a top 100 prospect on Fangraphs and a couple other. Keith Law's list also had him in the top 100 back in 2019, heading into the 2019 season. And then 2019, he went to high A, had kind of a meh year. He hit .265, .299 OBP, which is a problem, .397 slugging, nine home runs. And questions kind of started to continue about whether he can actually stick at catcher. And that's kind of the big questions with him is that people are unsure if he can catch and his approach is really raw. You know, he doesn't strike out a lot, which is good. Obviously, you know, we talk a lot about here on strikeout rate. He's about like 15% in the minors, which is well above average for someone his age. That's, you know, exactly what you want. But his walk rate is like 3-4%, and he's just not a very selective hitter. So even though he does make a lot of contact, it's a lot of bad contact where he'll get himself out just because he can, you know, hit a pitch that he shouldn't be swinging at. And that's why we kind of talk about, you know, just strikeout rate is not the be all end all when it comes to your hit tool. You know, you could have a really low strikeout rate and not be a good hitter still. And he's someone who just needs to work on his approach because even though he's not striking out, the hit tool is just not where it needs to be. And there are major questions with that.
But that's not to say that he doesn't have the raw power. I mean, it's
well,
plus
this
raw.
And this is what I was going to get to is, you know, talking to scouts. Those are there are people like you're going to focus on the warts. But with him, he also has two like big league quality tools in his raw power. It's easy plus raw power. You know, there's video of him on the internet hitting a home run in a Tampa inter-squad game back like right at the beginning of the summer camp or whatever it was called last year. And you can see it's just an absolute tank, just a line drive shot to the pull side. And he's got plus raw power and a question, you know, will he tap into it? But, you know, if he's average in game power, potentially that's very usable behind the plate. And then he's got a 70 arm, you know, it would be one of the best arms in the system. You know, I'm trying to think who else has a really good arm, like Alan Marrero has a good arm.
Pareda.
Yeah,
we
Pareda.
Haven't seen yet,
But yeah, it's like a plus plus arm. He can really control the running game. I believe he caught something like 46% of base stealers in 2019. His arm is plenty good enough to play stick behind the plate. It's just the framing and the receiving. That was the biggest thing in talking to scouts is there's serious questions about whether he can, you know, his framing and receiving ability. And that's something that we're not sure how much is going to matter going forward. Cause if there's robot umpires, don't care. But if there are not robot umpires and a six as is, you have to be able to frame, you have to be able to receive. And yeah, you know, he's got some question marks and at the same time, he's a catcher. The Red Sox catching depth is really poor. It's gotten a lot better though. Something it was interesting. I've noticed that it seems high in blue and high in Bloom and Co. have done a made a concerted effort to go out and target catchers in trades, because they've now acquired three since he took over and claimed Davey Grillon off waivers.
Who's now gone, with, but yeah.
Yeah, exactly. But with Hernandez, Connor Wong, and Jahani Pareda. So they've really improved the catching depth in the system. And he's a very interesting prospect who, if he, you know, comes in, maybe some swing mechanics changes, and he looks a little better behind the plate, then he's someone who I could see quickly moving into the top 10 in the system.
Mm-hmm. What year did you want caught stealing numbers for?
2019.
2019, he caught 24 out of 61 for a 39% rate.
Okay, maybe it's 46%.
He was at 57% in the Appy League in 2017 as a 19-year-old, so that's probably the number.
It's probably 46% for his career then.
It is. Yeah, that's exactly what it is. It's 100. Okay. It's 120 out of 200. It's exactly 46%.
Okay.
120 out of 260.
I knew there was a 46% somewhere.
Yep.
But yeah, I mean, it's the fact they were able to get him for two DFA pitchers is really interesting. But I talked to some people, and it makes more sense when you think about it from the Rays' perspective. Is basically they acquired three catchers this offseason in various trades and transactions. And Hernandez is going to be 23 this year, having not played above high A, but he's already on the 40 man. This will be his second option year. It's a timeline thing, right?
He got added to the 40. No,
2019, November 2019.
Okay. But we say he has three options remaining, which
he only has two options left.
Yeah. Okay.
And it's just a timing thing for them. You know, I think that they just didn't think they could keep him on the 40 man the entire season. They needed that spot for something else, which turned out to be pitching depth. And they went out and got Mazza, who we talked about as a solid, you know, depth reliever. And Jeffrey Springs, I was actually surprised, because if you look at his numbers, they're really bad. But if you delve a little deeper into them, he had one really bad outing at the beginning, but he struck out a ton of guys. And on StatCast, and according to scouts I talked to, he's actually someone that teams still like as a potential middle reliever. So the Rays doing Rays things, targeting, you know, undervalued pitchers that they like with Springs. So, yeah, Springs was 95th percentile in whiff rate, 83rd percentile in limiting exit velocity, 74th percentile K rate, 69th percentile in walk percentage. Like, there's a lot of red on his StatCast page, which is, and I guess he grades out well analytically, which is, you know, something the Rays obviously rely on heavily. So they basically thought, you know, we can turn a guy who we're not sure we can keep on our 40 at a position we've acquired a lot of stuff at this season for two pitchers who could help our MLB team this year. So, you know, I get it for them, but at the same time, great, you know, great job by the Red Sox in A, building enough pitching depth where they're able to DFA those two guys, but also B, you know, jumping on an opportunity when it presented itself in order to acquire a very interesting prospect at a position they need help at.
Yeah, and I think I oversold the trade a little bit at first, as you pointed out to me, which I think I might have gotten a little defensive, but thinking it through, you're right. I think it's a very sound, solid trade that, you know, I think, you know, the Rays have their reasons for making it. And I think that their catching depth is so much deeper now.
The headliners in two trades they made this season, or the second piece.
Catchers. Hunt, yeah.
With Blake Hunt, obviously from the Padres, who's, I think, his top 100 prospect on the site. FanGraphs has him top 100, least.
Okay.
I think ESPN might also, because he was really good at instructs, I guess.
Well, Kylie and Eric Longenhagen are basically the same guy still.
Then Herbito Hernandez, who you can debate if he's a catcher or not, but mm-hmm. he's also a top 100 guy, and he was the headliner in the Nate Lowe trade.
Yep.
Or Nate Lowe, I don't know. Even.
Yeah, Lowe, which one? Lowe, one of them's Lowe. I think it's Nate.
I think he's Lowe and Brandon Lowe.
Okay.
I think.
Anyway.
But anyway, in the Nate L trade was he was the headliner, and then obviously they also acquired Francisco Mejia in that same trade with the Padres for Blake Snell. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I think it was just kind of a roster management thing. They need, I mean, I think every team is looking at it. We're seeing with the Red Sox moves too. You're going to need pitching depth this year.
Yep. Yeah.
Every team knows that, because guys aren't ramped up. You know, I don't know if we'll see any pitchers go 200 innings this year, other than maybe like Lance Lynn, because he's an alien. Yeah,
right.
But you know, everyone else is going to go, you're going to have guys throwing 120, 140, 160 innings at most. You're going to need those depth 8, 9, 10 starters, you know, those 15, 16, 17th relief options. And Tampa clearly thought those two could help strengthen those areas, and the cost was something they were willing to do.
All right, Ian, moving similar to that, along the same lines of roster management, let's talk a little bit about the spring training camp roster that the Red Sox released. And just to give everyone the context, which I think is only a day old, Major League Camp this year is capped at 75 players. consisting of the 40-man roster and non-roster invites. So you can have, I mean, I guess it depends on how you want to call. You know, it's Chris weird. Sale like, went on the 60-day DL. So
Pawlecki's on the COVID list, so he doesn't count towards it right now. It's like,
well, does he weird. Count? Not, I think he doesn't count towards the 40. Does he count towards the 75?
I don't think so, but I'm not sure. It's a good question. I don't know the answer. Yeah.
Anyway, it's 75 guys. The Red Sox aren't at 75, nor do I think they will necessarily cap out.
I think they're at like 71 or 72 right now.
72, I think, is what they're at. Leave some room for, I mean, I think Marwin Gonzalez, oh no, with Marwin Gonzalez, they would be at 72, but Gonzalez isn't official yet.
Well, but Schreiber is. That was another move.
Well right, but they that's when they.
Oh, they actually IL'd right. They yeah, sale. They got rid of someone. You're right.
So yeah. So the Red. Oh, actually, do we want to talk about Schreiber? I don't really know much about him except he's a sidearmer. The Red Sox claimed on waivers a player
who's. I talked to Scout about him today. I can.
Whose get... name is something Schreiber? John Schreiber. Yes. Literally the most generic name, first name ever, and I can't remember it. Off waivers from Detroit, right-handed side armor, great minor league numbers. Major league numbers look bad, but his like FIP and XFIP are much lower, so it looks like there's some bad luck in small sample sizes, but seems to me like an up-and-down guy, Ian, with three options left.
Yeah, I mean, I was surprised. I was not really paying attention, and I just got a text that was like, hey, I actually kind of like John Schreiber as like a low cost relief option. And I was like, I have no idea who you're talking about. And he's like, oh, the Red Sox just claimed him. And I was like, oh, okay. So I did some digging. And yeah, he's someone who's excelled in the minor leagues. You know, back in 2019 in AAA, he was 2.28 ERA. K9 was at over 10 in 59 innings.
His and K so, per 9 was actually over 10 in his first stint in the majors. It's just well, that he also got hit. But go
that's
ahead.
What I was going to get to. Yeah, in the majors, same thing. You know, he struck guys out. He's just getting – it's just – I don't know if it's luck or what you said, but his ERA FIP-XFIP split is crazy.
Yeah.
And he doesn't – and part of it's because he doesn't walk anyone. He's got really good control. And that was the main thing that scouts almost mentioned to me was that he throws a ton of strikes. And, yeah, it's just – it's really weird stuff. You know, it's 88 to 91 from a low arm slot with, a you know, his best pitch is probably his solid – it's a sweepy slider, you know, that sidearm, you know, frisbee slider. And the big question is because of that slot, can he get lefties out? But as like a cheap, you know, middle relief guy, I'm fine taking a look. And I think the most interesting part about it to me was just he's so against the mold of all the other arms they've really targeted or added over the past, you know, year. When you think about it, they're really going for velocity and spin rate guys for break, you know, overhand slots is the majority of the guys they've been targeting. And now, you know, you've got this really funky sidearm guy. And I think he could, you know, give a different look in their bullpen. Because if you look at it right now, it's a bunch of guys who throw really hard and then him if he makes the team. So you never know. You know, it's always good to have different looks and we'll kind of see what happens.
Yeah. Yeah. It seems to, like I said, it seems to me like an up and down guy, but anything interesting? We don't want to go over the whole 72 guy list, Ian. You know, there's guys. I mean, the Red Sox signed Hirokazu Sawamura, mostly a major league guy. I don't know if you want to get
we
into the scouting report.
Already.
Did we talk think, about him already?
Yeah, we did.
Yeah. Yeah, because he was basically signed. Anything stand out to you as surprising with the NRIs or anything like that, Ian? Nothing really. I mean, the only triple guys we had ticketed for AAA that didn't get invites were utility infielder Jack Lopez, outfielder Johan Meneses, and you know, infielder outfielder Joey Meneses. You know, they're AAA depth guys. Nothing really surprised me. The couple things that I did notice: Mike Schwarren and Bobby Pointer not getting invited. Not good for them.
No.
Not a good
I mean,
look.
That basically says we don't consider you major league depth this year, which for
they're
them
AAA
is...
depth. Yeah. Yeah. You know, that's not a great sign for them. Couple of surprises. Biggest one that for you was Nick York. Do you want to talk about why that was? And I'm not disagreeing that it was a huge surprise, but...
Just, I mean, I just thought they would mostly stick to... basically guys who would help the big league team or were on the 40-man roster. And I mean, I understand like Costas is on it, Duran, like the top prospects are on it who are close to the big leagues or at least could be it. Cause I think Costas is going to get pushed pretty aggressively this year. I just have a feeling that I would not be surprised at all if he starts the year in Portland, honestly. And which I think we haven't projected for right now.
Yeah, we do.
Even though he's had what, you know, 7 at bats in Salem or something in his career.
Plus playoffs, but yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I just think it's interesting because York, obviously, you know, he's an 18-year-old. He's still 18. He's going to be 18 all of camp, and they were just clearly comfortable enough with his offensive ability and his feel for hit to throw him in there against guys, you know, who are big league ready for the most part, almost all the arms other than Jay Groom or guys, you know, I think you could conceivably see having a future in the big leagues at some point this year or maybe next year. So, yeah, I just thought he was pretty interesting, and I'm interested to hear the reports on how he handles that kind of aggressive assignment to start, especially because the other part for me that was interesting is because of the way the minor league schedule is structured, he's going to basically have to ramp down for a month, or basically just he'll go straight into minor league spring training, I guess.
Yeah, he'll be at minor league spring training. Let's actually mention that now, because that's a good transition, is that the minor league season for Double A and below will start on May the 4th and run through September 19th.
Yes.
No playoffs, no All-Star game.
Triple A starts April 6th, I believe, and runs through the same time. I love the schedule, though, I have to say. Mondays are always on the uniform off day, always on a Monday, and then they just play Tuesday to Sunday. It's just incredible. And this should be kept permanently because it's so much better than.
It's a travel thing. It's not a COVID thing.
Okay, good. Because it's really good. And I'm interested to see how. It's going to be nice to have baseball back hopefully soon.
Yeah, it's like, why do you need to have 3-game series in the minors?
It makes no sense, because it's like, why would you go to for Pawtucket? Like, Pawtucket has to go out to, I don't know, where's the farthest possible Pawtucket opponent usually?
I don't know, New Orleans or something? Or is New Orleans in the PCL?
No, that they're in the PCL. It'd be like Erie. Erie's...
Oh, Charlotte, maybe. Charlotte or Durham. Charlotte.
Yeah, if you're going to Charlotte or Durham, why would you go there twice? Why would you pay to fly there twice for 2-3-game sets when you can just go down there for a week and knock all those games out?
Yeah.
And the same thing is, you know, you can go knock out Charlotte and Durham back-to-back weeks. Obviously, the road trips and stuff will be longer, but I'd rather that than have to go down there, you know, 4 times over the course of the year.
Yeah, and I mean, it's you know, they're basically making the minor leagues a development program, which is what it is. And it's like, you know, the reason that minor leagues didn't have unbalanced schedules was like competing for a championship and stuff like that. But it's like, who remembers who won the South Atlantic League last year other than like the people in attendance at that game? Seriously, like, who cares? For me, I mean, it's nice for the employees of the team, but it's like the A-ball leagues had rules such that you made the playoffs based on your first half or your second half schedule. The reason being that those teams change so much, they want to make sure the teams that were good in one half or the other didn't get punished by getting their guys called up. And it's like, well, if that's how you're operating, who cares about the playoffs? Not about, I don't know.
Because also with the playoffs too, it's by that time, as you said, a lot of the guys have been promoted. So the guys who started the season weren't even there anymore. And it's also when you get all the way to the playoffs, like it's kind of, you know, some teams get to play 2-3 weeks longer than the others. Why not just have everyone play that length? Like, it never made sense to me why you're cutting it off.
And you're promoting guys to rosters. Like, I remember in the playoffs last year, the Red Sox promoted Jagger Rusconi off of the Salem Red Sox to make room for Tristan Casas, Tyler Esplin, and the guys that got called up from Low-A Greenville.
Yeah.
Like, what the hell's the point of that? That's just extra development for certain guys. It's not a true playoff atmosphere experience. Lowell Spinners with
Lowell was hilarious.
Tom Wendell, like, what? He's a triple A pitcher.
Donnie Baldwin was playing catcher because they didn't really have a catcher, and then they were playing Sedane Rafaela and Matthew Lugo were like playing even though they were on the team for 2 games in the regular season,
so anyway, I think it's okay. But doubling back, a couple more surprises I wanted to mention for NRIs. One a little bit for me was AJ Politi. Knew they liked him. To me, it's cemented that he's probably ticketed for Portland, and we adjusted our projection accordingly.
I agree. I also think, though, I wonder what of it is, like, he's already 24. He's almost 20. He's going to be 25, I think, this summer.
That
they need to see what he is. You know, if he goes to High A Salem, Greenville. I'm going to screw that up so much. But if he went to High A to start the year as a 24-year-old, you know, he ends the year as a 25-year-old, maybe in Double A. Next year, he goes back to Double A as a 20. He's someone they need to push aggressively because of his age. And it's not his fault. You know, he's a 4-year college guy. That's what happens with those guys. But yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. The other one that surprised me a little bit, but it makes sense when you look at the depth chart, is Cole Cottom. Cottom certainly to me ticketed for High A just because of depth. But they need a lot of catchers to catch all of the pitchers they have.
Well, that's the biggest thing.
They would have been calling a guy up from minor league camp to fill that role anyway. So, hey, let's bring in the next guy up in terms of a catching prospect. I get it.
And you look at it, it's like, you know, we have all of the starting catcher and the primary reserve for, you know, all four levels, except for Salem, for Greenville, Portland, and Greenville, Portland, and Worcester.
I think I would have the catching depth chart a little bit different than what we have on our projections page. But, and by the way, if anyone goes to our projections page, don't email us that Connor Wong is on there twice, please. We've got guys on there multiple times. If we because what we think is going to happen is that a guy like Connor Wong or Johnny Pareda is going to go to Pawtucket to start the year.
Yeah.
And then in May, when the minor league season starts up, they're probably going to demote some guys from Pawtucket or, gosh, Worcester.
Yes.
From Worcester to Portland because they want those guys playing.
Exactly. Yeah. Because as you said, Worcester is going to need extra depth guys, just like Boston is going to be using Worcester for their depth. So Worcester's going to have guys ready to go, especially with catchers and pitchers. So I bet they're going to break camp with, as you said, you know, more than 28 or whatever. And some of those guys will just go down to Portland when the season starts because it's a full month later, basically.
Anything else on roster, Ian? They did add a couple of guys that I was a little surprised that didn't get in our eyes. Like, I think Michael Geddes didn't get an invite previously, but has one now.
I thought he had one before, but maybe he didn't.
Maybe it was like, no point.
Oh, no, he didn't. He didn't. You're right. It was Yairo Munoz didn't have one either.
We thought he would be in the next round of guys. Anyway, we also didn't mention they signed Chris Herman.
I was just about to say that. Yeah. I mean, we talked about it on the last episode. I said they needed to sign a major league catcher. He's perfect.
Exactly who. Yeah.
Yep.
Put it this way. Not that I'm predicting this would happen, but if you were to ask who else on this team could get traded, top of both of our lists is Christian Vasquez, right?
Yes.
If they wanted to go Kevin Plawecki, Chris Herman for 2021,
I'd be fine with it.
I'd be okay with it.
But in terms of players I think are realistically available with who's left, he's the one who has the most trade value, and I don't think it's that close.
Right.
Because trading the Devers, Bogarts, Verdugo group. You can't trade Martinez or Eovaldi, guys like that, really. And Eduardo Rodriguez, I don't know what his trade value would be. I don't think it makes sense to discuss him. So you're looking at it's like Matt Barnes and Christian Vasquez is basically all that's left. The other thing, though, I think we need to talk about a little bit just with Marwin Gonzalez is I think this secures the fact that Michael Chavis is headed to AAA, which is something I've been kind of pushing or saying is likely to happen for a few months now. But I just think with the versatility they've established on the MLB level, and I believe Alex Cora talked about it in an interview, that they're perfectly fine running a three-man bench. And I just think that teams are going to want to carry as many pitchers as possible. So having the versatility they do with Gonzalez, Kike Hernandez, Christian Arroyo, basically covers every spot on the field. So
Verdugo
can
cover all three can cover both center and right.
So they can run a three-man bench because of that. And I just don't see any way that Michael Chavis fits in that because of his limitations.
Well, and it's because he's completely redundant with Christian Arroyo.
Exactly.
Same-handedness. Arroyo's a little bit more versatile because have they played Chavis on the left side of the infield in the majors? No. So I think
Arroyo can play short and third a little bit.
I mean, I'm very interested to see who the backup shortstop is going to be because is it Gonzalez, Arroyo, or Kike Hernandez?
They have three guys who can do it. I honestly wonder if something did happen to Xander, if they would just play all of them. Like, you know, each one of them would play a couple days and we'll see what happens.
Or it depends on how Jeter Downs or Jonathan Arruz looks in AAA.
Well, exactly. Right? And I do think, though, that with the current roster construction, it's pretty clear that Kike Hernandez is an everyday player. Like, he's going to play
somewhere.
He's going to play somewhere every game. And I think it's probably second base against righties and left field against lefties. But I think he's going to play a lot. And I mean, it's weird. I'm very interested to see the Red Sox this year.
Yeah.
You know, I'm more so than I think I have been the past couple of years. Cause it's just a really interesting team. It's a very different roster construction than we're used to. And we kind of got accustomed to under the Dave Dombrowski era, you know,
They've never had a constructed roster like this.
No, it's versatile. It's a bunch of high energy guys. There's, you know, they actually have pitching depth now, which is good. You know, there's minor leaguers coming in there's a very interesting minor leaguers coming that we potentially could see impacting the major league team this year. You know, there's a lot of interesting things going on with the Red Sox, which I think we'll talk more about when we get, you know, deeper into spring training. Which was worth mentioning.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to seeing how the different permutations of I should probably do a chart of all the lineups this year. I know Baseball Reference has things like that too, but just, you know, as a way to keep myself sane, you know, during intense work times, but just like, you know, just seeing all the different permutations that they have, and how they're using guys and where they're looking at guys, because Cora is going to have to work out in camp where guys fit and how he's going to use them, because that's not necessarily just going to be dictated by Bloom in the front office. They're going to provide him with information, but that's the manager's job.
Well, and I think that's something that he showed that he can do during that title run. He was very good at it. And I think we're going to see a lot of the situations where the Red Sox use 10, 11, 12 position players in a game. You know, I think we're going to see, you know, a lot of pinch hitting later in games. We're going to see guys moving around positionally, like stuff like that, that maybe you're more used to seeing in the NL game. But I think the Red Sox, it's something that they could employ. And it's something, frankly, the Rays have been doing for years to great effect.
Yeah, and you know, that said, I think we talked about the potential three-man bench. I do think there's a situation where they go with a four-man bench, and that's if they sign. At this point, the only guy that I could see is Mitch Moreland, because everyone else is kind of wrapped up.
Except Shaw signed. He signed today.
Did he sign today with whom?
Yeah, Oakland.
Oh, I didn't even see it.
Okay. Oakland went on a little spending spree and signed him and Trevor Rosenthal. So.
Oh, I saw the Rosenthal signing. I didn't see
They signed Mitch Moreland also.
Okay, I mean, I could see, like, they've made some noise about a left-handed bench bat.
But I think Marwin Gonzalez is that to me.
But is he? Like, he's not a bat.
He's fine.
They signed him for $3 million. I mean, like, is Marwin Gonzalez your backup first baseman? To me, I don't think he is. I mean, to me?
I think he is.
You think?
Yeah.
I mean, is it weird to say? I mean, look, like, would it be the worst thing to teach Devers to play a little bit of first? I don't know. Maybe not. I want him working on third base more.
We talked about it with Eddie. He's a third baseman.
Yeah. I mean, he was talking about when they signed him at 16.
I just kind of assumed that was still applicable now, because I think he's a third baseman.
I think it is. I think he is too. I'm saying having that versatility wouldn't be the worst thing. But if, I want him to focus on getting better at third. I'm with you on that.
I know what you mean.
I was thinking out loud. I'm with you. I'm very much looking forward to analyzing this roster, what they do with the AAA guys, what they do with the minor leaguers, how that affects. If you've got a six-day, like, do you almost go with a six? Maybe you don't go with a six-man rotation, but... Because even with a five-man rotation, you know you're going to have one turn where you pitch Tuesday, Sunday. Like, it's going to be weird how they keep guys on rotations.
Well, that's the thing that's the having the same off day every time kind of makes it weird because whoever pitches, people are going to be getting extra rest. Like, one guy is going to get that extra, or not one guy, four guys are going to get that extra rest each week. So
yeah, like, are you going to skip a guy for a start or something, or have like piggyback guys to keep them on? I don't know. It's interesting. Anyway, is there anything else we've got to get to, Ian, or should we wrap it up? All right, we're not going to have an outro after the Eddie interview. So thank you all for listening. Thank you to Podcast Joe 2.0. for editing, producing, putting together the show. We owe him huge. Follow us on Twitter. Follow Ian at Ian Cundall. Follow me at Chris Hatfield. I didn't spell your name. It's I-A-N-C-U-N-D-A-L-L, Ian Cundall, on Twitter. Follow the website at Sox Prospects. Thank you to our musical, not guest, to our the Ludlow Thieves for our intro and outro music. Catch them on Spotify or wherever it is that you listen to music these days. We'll be back at you soon. Hopefully not before too long. We're going to have baseball to talk about. That's a good thing. Thanks y'all for listening. We'll be back at you soon. All right. Continuing the Sox Prospects podcast guest heater that we're on. We are very pleased to welcome Red Sox Executive Vice President and Assistant General Manager, Eddie Romero, to the show. Eddie, we've wanted to have you on for a while, and I said this with Ben a couple episodes ago. I have no idea why it hadn't happened yet, but we're really glad to get you on. And I think based on that episode, I need to ask, first of all, are you getting promoted in the next 2 or 3 days such that we need to know what your actual title is going to be? Because that happened to us last time.
I hope so. That'd be amazing. But no. Thanks for having me on, guys. You guys are doing awesome work. Congratulations on what, 200 plus shows now. And, I can only hope I do as well as Haim and Ben have done in the past couple weeks.
Well, having talked to you before plenty at the backfields and whatnot, I'm sure that won't be an issue. We always love getting to see you at spring training and stuff like that. And hopefully we get to see you at actual baseball games again soon. But, you know, we've got a lot to talk about, and we've only got you for so long. So I guess I'll dive right into it. And where I want to start, Eddie, is kind of at the start. Not just because there may be, you know, for example, present day lawyers who are interested in, you know, say if they wanted to get the hell out of the industry, how that might work and get into baseball and become a assistant general manager of a baseball team. Not that I'm talking for myself. I'm mostly kidding if my employer's listening, but, kidding aside, how'd you get into the game? Because obviously your father has been in the game, you know, as a player and as a coach for a long time. And that path obviously makes sense, but it's not like you immediately got into baseball. You took the other role where you went to law school and became a lawyer for a while. What led to you making the decision to jump into the game and begin working in baseball as opposed to kind of, you know, not necessarily specifically the legal field, but just, you know, choosing another path?
Sure. Well, obviously growing up, you know, in the game, it was, you know, I wanted to be a baseball player and, you know, going through high school and everything and, you know, being unathletic, slow, and not able to hit, it was, you know, my dad gave me a pretty blunt scouting report. So I knew I was going to have to go to the college route and not play and do what most of us do and get real world jobs. Right. Mm-hmm. And so, I interned with the Brewers in 2002 and then, you know, kind of made the decision there whether to stay in baseball. I had been offered a job and or go to law school. And law school was something that had always intrigued me. I wanted to get an advanced degree. So I made the tough call to go back to UF and go through another 3 years of law school. And I'm incredibly glad I did it. And, you know, after that, I like many job seekers, you know, I was asking everybody, sending resumes, hitting up all of my contacts, and I wasn't able to secure anything in the game. And so obviously frustrated, possibly, you know, like, you know, regretting things and wondering why I had maybe have rejected the one opportunity that I had. But becoming a prosecutor was incredible. I worked in Jacksonville at the state attorney's office for just about 1 year, and it was an incredible experience. I did, you know, I was handling misdemeanor DUIs, domestic batteries, you know, low volume drugs, things like that. And being in the courtroom right away was, you know, competitive and it got your juices flowing. But again, like the experience of that is priceless. And so, at the end of the, you know, that first year there, I got a call from the Red Sox, from Craig Shipley and Ben Cherington. And it was a swift transition, you know, to be able to hop into an international role with the Red Sox, somebody that, you know, my dad had played with and I, as a kid had spent in Boston, was obviously like my dream come true. And that's kind of all she wrote.
Did you know that international scouting was kind of the area you wanted to get into, or was it, you know, because there's obviously something of a national fit, natural fit there, or was it just kind of that was the opportunity that came up and it worked out as well as it did?
I didn't care, you know, what I did. For me, it was just getting a foot in the door. You know, I knew that being bilingual was going to help, and the fact that I had grown up around the game. You know, and again, like I loved what I did that 1 year, but I know you mentioned to me you had deposition training the other day. Those right. were the kinds of things that I was so happy to leave behind. That again, if I had been a gopher, you know, for 5 years, I would have been fine doing that with a big league club.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So you start with the club, you're an assistant in the international and professional scouting department, and you eventually work your way up to being the director of international scouting, I think right after Ship, right?
Right.
Yeah. So when you take over the department, you know, how has it evolved from that point in 2012 to now? What has changed about how the club does things? And I know that there's probably a ton that could fall under there, and we'll certainly ask about some of the things. But just, you know, 10,000 foot level, big picture wise, what do you see as the big successes and big changes?
Yeah, I think at that time, you know, the international market overall was still seen as kind of a supplementary, you know, distributor of talent to clubs. It wasn't something that teams were completely focused on and dedicating resources to. And there were some clubs that took advantage of that early on, you know, and were spending money, big money in that arena more, you know, before everybody was like, we really need to pay attention and dedicate resources to this talent pipeline. And I think, you know, in 2012, when we first, you know, started looking at the department overall, we just noticed that it was quite undermanned. You know, we had three scouts in the Dominican. We had four or five scouts in Venezuela. We were, you know, we were deficient in coverage in several other regions. And so, you know, and only recently we had started, like, you know, requiring a central reporting database. You know, we had just started making our scouts prepare reports you know, where we could all read them. And so right out of the chute, you know, with Ben Charrington, we were able to add some scouts. We were able to shrink some coverage areas, which was key. You know, we had one scout basically covering Central and East Venezuela. Like, that's just impossible for one person to do. We continued kind of fine-tuning the reporting database and what we expected from our scouts. We added a cross-checker in Rolly Pino, who's, you know, obviously been one of our better talent evaluators over the years. And we invested a lot in our Dominican facility. You know, we upgraded it. We made it so that, you know, we could house more players. We could house more tryout players. And overall, really over the years, we've just organized our process on, you know, the amount of looks, the priority lists, our video organization. We've become way more strategic with our scheduling. So, you know, and over the past couple of years, one of the most exciting, like, additions that we've had, one of the things that is really driving us has been the use of technology at the Academy, you know, for both PD and evaluation, you know, that we've added personnel strictly for that. And I you know, having a development coach down there to act as like an intermediary between the coaches and the players and our analytics staff in Boston. And that has been something where it's really neat to see how our scouts, our players, just how they really have taken to that. And it's neat to see, like, where there's no pushback on that. Guys are very accepting.
Mm-hmm. And I guess that's another thing I wanted to kind of touch on too, where the Dominican Academy and the DSL program, and I've always kind of wondered about this, is it something of a hybrid really between the international, I guess, scouting technically department and player dev, where it's sort of a little bit of both? Is it more international? Is it more player dev? What goes into that program there versus, you know, coming in from either side?
Sure. The Academy is the base for both, you know, it's for both international and kind of, you know, international scouting and player development. You know, we run the Academy from mid January to mid December. And, you know, during the DSL season, it's kind of more PD focused. And obviously this has all been affected by the pandemic,
of course,
yeah. But, you know, it serves as the basis for both. And we have such a good staff down there led by Jose Zapata, who doesn't get enough credit for, you know, like, it's crazy. Like, we see Xander Bogaerts and Rafael Devers here, and then Darwinson Hernandez, and the first person they ask for is, how's Zapata doing? He does such a good job of integrating tryout players into our programs, our coaching staff. You know, we have some coaches that have scouting backgrounds. That helps so much with talent evaluation, with makeup, you know, getting to know these guys. And so it really is, you know, what I'm very proud of, the balance that we've been able to develop there. And very, very few of these signed players that we've had have not, you know, the large majority have come through the hands of Zapata and his staff, and they've given, you know, positive reviews on those guys.
You know, With the DSL, as far as how it functions, we tell people, you know, it's really something like international, maybe Legion Ball, which I don't mean to discredit it, but it's just, it's really interesting in terms of how that works. Can you talk a little bit about what the players at the Academy are doing? You mentioned it's January to December, you know, with like a month off in kind of the half months at the end and beginning of the year. What are the guys doing down there? And then can you talk a little bit about it? It's more than the DSL, right? Because I don't know how much you can talk about the tricky league and things like that for the guys who've just signed. You know, at a given time, it seems like there's a lot of activity there that's really going on under the radar for folks.
Yeah, it's I mentioned we run it for basically 11 months a year. It's usually around 70 players, all these players that have been signed for us. And we have kind of a separate area for tryout players so that they can, you know, like, they can stay away from the population of the players that have already signed with us. As you mentioned, like, around what has traditionally been July 2nd, we sign a group of, you know, usually 15 to 20 guys around that date, and those guys get introduced into the program. Now, since there are players that are signed for next year, and that's why they sign on July 2nd, the first day after the midpoint of the year, those guys, they can enter your academy and just train. And so what we do was actually Manny Nanita, our scouting supervisor in the Dominican years ago, with someone that worked with the Texas Rangers, came up with the idea of the Tricky League, which was kind of a non-sanctioned league where we'd have 15 to 20 teams play each other in this little Tricky League. And it's really like the first taste of professional baseball for those players that have just recently signed. And, you know, you can mix in tryout players. You can, you know, run, you know, you can run the game as easily as you want. You can relax the rules. So it's a great learning environment. You know, it's funny because Zapata is the manager for that team, and it's turned out great. Like, we've gotten great looks. We've signed a bunch of, like, Roberto Jimenez, before we signed him, he had played and performed in about 2 weeks worth of Tricky League games. So he then signed and immediately kept playing with the Tricky League team. But yeah, you know, we did a renovation to the academy about 2 years ago, and it's, you know, state of the art now. It's beautiful. We have a brand new dormitory. We have two full fields, one half field, a state of the art batting cage. Our weight room there is incredible. And so that's just allowed us to continue to provide these, you know, services for our players, giving them exactly what they need. When they finish practice, they have, you know, mandatory English classes, and it's like a baseball boarding school. It's baseball 24 hours a day, and you know, it's trying to get them ready for the States.
Can I just ask, where does the name Tricky League come from?
That is everything in the Dominican has a nickname, right? And uh-huh. And it's beautiful, and that country is so amazing, and it's so refreshing because baseball is number one by a long shot there, as you know. Mm-hmm. And I have no clue. I've asked that question myself. Nobody can give me a direct answer, but that's just what it is. It's a Tricky League.
All right. I guess it's one of those things where if you need to ask, you shouldn't know or something, maybe. I don't know. That's interesting.
Yeah. Nobody knows the exact origin of it, but it's perfect.
Maybe switching gears back a little bit to the international scouting and signing piece. Obviously, you know, I look in the media guide and there's like more than 30, you know, scouts and coordinators in the department at this point, and I'm sure I'm missing a section where there might be more people, especially when you have people at the academy who maybe serve in multiple roles. But there's, you know, scouting in the U.S. where, okay, scouting in Texas versus scouting in Florida is one thing, but the international scouting department has to scout in not just the different parts of Latin America, which are all different, the challenges in the Dominican versus Venezuela versus, you know, I'm sure even a country, you know, a smaller area like, you know, like Curacao, Aruba type area. You've got, you know, Japan and you know, the and Asia. Scouting in different parts of the world, how do they present unique issues? Is there anything in particular that, you know, you guys have to work through in different areas? Or is it just a matter of getting someone on the ground there who's familiar with it and knows what needs to happen in a different place? Because it's such a vast area. It seems daunting to me to even have enough boots on the ground to find all that there is to get out there.
Sure, that's a good question. It's a good point. You know, fortunately, we have resources, so we can spread out. You know, and there's very few places that we, as you know, directors and cross checkers, we you know, just about everywhere we go, we have somebody on the ground. You know, and so that helps. You know, for example, like Louis Lin, our scout in Taiwan, he's got connections throughout China. So, you know, we went on a scouting trip to China once. We meet up with Louis Lin there. We see the players. He's got his contacts, and we know that we can get around there safely, and we don't have to worry about anything else. We can focus on players. Same in, like, New Zealand. Like, Brett Ward has contacts in New Zealand. So if we go scout there, we know that we can meet Brett there, and we don't have to worry about anything else. So that helps a lot. But, yeah, you know, it's – there are everywhere you go, like, especially when you're going to the first time, there's always some level of unease. But again, it's building that international network. And you mentioned Venezuela. Venezuela is obviously a huge pipeline of talent. And, you know, one of the difficulties there now is just getting in, you know, like right now, right. Not with COVID, you know, there's visa requirements and everything. Like, intrastate travel alone is difficult there. But we're waiting for them, you know, just to open up their borders so we can get back in there. And, you know, we've been a very aggressive team in that country. And we've had, you know, it's funny, you got Alex Cora at spring training yesterday was just mentioning about how how we had a heavy Venezuelan influence in spring with, you know, some homegrown guys and like Bazzardo and Mata and Darwinson, but also with the free agents with like Martin and Marwin Gonzalez and those guys. So, you know, that's obviously a place that we need to continue to focus on. And we hope that in the near future, it can be a little bit easier to do there.
You started talking about players, and we were just kind of wondering and looking, you guys obviously during your time have had success developing both pitchers and hitters. Some of the names you mentioned, and obviously, you know, you got the hitters, you got Rafael Devers, Xander Bogaerts, guys like that. Can you talk a little bit about, in your experience, is it easier to scout international when they're pitchers or hitters, or do they both present their own challenges that it's kind of a case by case basis?
It's definitely case by case. I mean, you know, when we're, it's so hard. You know, I know I've mentioned this in the past to Chris, like when we have zero makeup information, zero medical information, zero performance history. We're basically going off, and we've had very little, you know, technological support up until these past couple of years. So we're basically going off of what we're seeing, what our area scouts are seeing, what they're able to relay to us in their reports and off of video. So whenever you're able to, you know, set up a competitive environment for 2, 3, 4 days, be it, you know, ourselves on the ground in the Dominican or wherever, or an international tournament, you know, the 18 and under, the 15 and under, the 16 and under, those are really the arenas where we have to make quick decisions on. So I don't think that, you know, one is easier than the other, but it's just really tough, man. And there's so much luck that goes into it. You just have to hope that you're in the right place at the right time for the right price. And then that's when, you know, hopefully you can pop somebody.
I mean, Alex Speer in his book, you know, wrote, and he, I'm sure in articles as well, for example, about, you know, the Xander Bogaerts, what did he have, strep or something when, yeah, I mean, are there any other kind of just experiences like that where, you know, it's a guy who winds up signing and we just get him based on seemingly pure luck, but I would argue, you know, there's some element of making your own luck by making sure you got someone there, but does anyone stand out as kind of a good example of that sort of right place at the right time sort of thing?
Well, it's funny because, you know, I know before the call we were mentioning the Basabe twins a little bit, mm-hmm. and those guys were, you know, obviously it's rare to find a set of twins and you like both players and their names happen to be nearly identical. But that was the case. You know, we were in Eastern Venezuela and we saw these two, you know, super athletic kids, great kids, and we liked both of them. And then, you know, they, every time that we saw them, we would put them in a competitive environment facing live pitchers. And they would always rake against everybody except this big, strong left-handed kid who didn't know where the ball was going. And every time we went back in, the same lefty would throw. And we'd talk to both Luis Alejandro and Luis Alexander and say, hey, you know, like, what are you guys? Are you guys doing this? You swinging and missing on purpose because this pitcher is in your program? And they were like, no, man, his ball moves all over the place. We can't see it, whatever. And that was Darwinson Hernandez. And it's funny because we literally signed Darwinson. We loved his physicality and everything, but it was like everybody, you know, the Basabe twins hit everybody except this guy, and these guys are pretty good hitters. So, you know, we should take a flyer on this guy. And, again, we got lucky. Darwinson has done a tremendous job with our PD department of improving his mechanics, and you know, now the product is in the big leagues. So that was one story. It's like, if this guy keeps striking these two out, we should probably sign him.
I think I saw both his best and worst starts the year he was in Salem. I think I saw him not last an inning once, and then I saw him just shove for eight. So he's a guy that I like, you know, having seen at his best and worst in the minors, and we can see what he is now.
I'll give you one other funny story.
Sure.
It was, we were in the Dominican and we had invited Anderson Espinoza to the complex from Venezuela. Mm-hmm. And we had talked to Pedro Martinez about coming, and I was like, Pedro, you know, like, please sit down when you're in the dugout, you know, don't go crazy over anybody, because if you do, you know, like that, they might jack up the price. And Noza comes out and he starts, you know, doing what he does, is mm-hmm. throwing 90-91 as a 16-year-old, and he's flipping curveballs in and good feel for his changeup and everything. And Pedro from the dugout, I'm sitting behind home plate, starts hey, this is the guy you got to sign, Eddie. You know, and I'm like, oh, my God, Pedro. Like, he's this kid reminds me of me. And, of course, like, oh after, God. You know, like, the second hits, we negotiate with the agent. And he's like, this is the next Pedro Martinez, according to Pedro Martinez. So,
it's hard to argue with that.
Yeah, exactly. This one, that one probably cost us a little bit more, but that was another really good story that we laugh about it now. And I hope, Anderson, you know, I spoke to him a little while ago on via WhatsApp. I you know, hope for the best for him that he can get healthy because he's tremendously talented.
Yeah, I was going to ask if you'd heard about him. Yeah,
yeah, I was going to say he's someone I saw back with Greenville, and it blew me away. I've never seen someone as polished with that type of breaking ball. I think he was 18 at the time and obviously had some setbacks. But, yeah, hoping for the best for him because there's so much talent there still.
Yeah, tremendous kid, hard worker. You know, he just had some bad luck health-wise, and just, yeah, wishing him the best because he is, like I mentioned, he's a special talent.
Eddie, a lot's been kind of made about the you know, in MLB, international scouting on, you know, improvements they should make or have made and whether the current system is good or not. And I guess kind of two parts to this. And first, you know, in recent years, what kind of reforms and changes do you think MLB has put in place in international scouting that are positive that you think really have made a difference?
Well, I think, you know, especially now with the pandemic, you know, MLB, you know, put in some protocols to really take care of the scouts. You know, they shut down all international travel for a while, all in-person scouting. And I think that was really, you know, the right move to do given everything that, you know, we're living through. And then, you know, a couple months ago, they opened it up, and there's still strict protocols. There's limits on the numbers of player of team personnel, of scouts that can go and evaluate players at events, which I think is very smart. And they're really enforcing, you know, along with the agents themselves. You know, they've got the trainer partnership program, which has been a real help to clubs because through this program, they provide drug testing, they provide supplies to the agents, they provide, you know, supplements, legal supplements to the players. And so, you know, that's one thing that in addition to like what they do in terms of investigating ages and identifications, give us as teams like more security knowing that, you know, the player that we're getting is who we think he is and that age and that there's no, you know, shenanigans in the background. So that's been a tremendous help for us. And, you know, now is, hopefully we can, you know, get vaccinated soon and you know, get the whole pandemic behind us at some point, hopefully later this year. I'm sure some of those restrictions will be lifted and we can get back to scouting in a normal environment.
Yeah, you know, when you said that, it made me realize I haven't had to think about, like, background checks as a thing in a long time. When it seemed like every international player we signed, it's, you know, oh, they'll announce it when the background checks are done. So that's a great point. The other thing that I wanted to ask you about is, you know, in terms of some things that could change in the future, we've heard a lot about the potential for an international draft. And I know obviously there's only so much you could potentially say about it, given that A, it's speculating and, you know, B, you know, who knows what you know or don't know that you can say on or off the record. But in terms of general, the proposition of an international draft, you know, how do you think that would affect things? Positive thing? What thought, if you have any thoughts on the potential imposition of an international player draft?
Yeah, you know, it's been a heavily debated, you know, topic over the past few years, and it's just something that will continue to be discussed going forward. And I'm sure, you know, with the CBA discussions at the end of this year, I'm sure it'll be brought up again. It's interesting, you know, because the good thing about the current setup is that if you want to spend your entire allotment on one player, on your number one player, you can, in order to insure that player, or you can divvy it up however you want. And the beauty of it is if you want, you know, to go after your top five players and you agree to sign them, you sign those five players. You don't have to compete with anybody else if you meet their demands. You know, a lot of times when we look at our priority list, we're able to sign many of our top 30, or at least, you know, a few of them that obviously in a draft would be much more unlikely to do. The one, you know, one benefit of the draft is just some more organization. You could get better process knowing that you're going to have access to the player up until X date. and everything that goes in that, you know, whether you can do medical checks beforehand, you can get to know the kid and do your makeup background checks beforehand, and, you know, everybody will have a fair shot at evaluating the player. So that's one of the benefits, that's one of the potential benefits of the draft, but we'll see what happens. I mean, we're obviously keenly aware of what's going on or what will go on with the draft, as it could obviously be incredibly impactful to this department.
Mm-hmm. All right, maybe changing gears a little bit to just kind of the players who are in this, in the organization, in the system that, you know, they, you know, you guys have signed during your time with the team. And I guess just to start, you mentioned a few of the guys we wanted to ask you about, you know, Darwin's and guys like that, but you know, what can you tell us about, like, the, you know, maybe the scouting and or development of a guy like Rafael Devers, for example, who's a key part of the team now? Does anything come to mind of kind of his, you know, scouting process or development process that stands out to you now looking back, as, you know, he's one of the key parts of the major league team?
It's amazing to see, you know, how far he's come. But when I think back to our process with him, Raffy came to us just as much as we went to Raffy. You know, he was a Red Sox fan. He made it known from the outset. You know, if he wasn't likable enough, this will make you like him even more. You know, Raffy had better offers with other teams, and his agent was adamant that he was like, we have to find a way to make this work because this kid wants to be the third baseman for the Boston Red Sox. And so it's funny, and it wasn't, you know, I'm sure you guys have heard there were some bumps along the way where he some good lessons, some valuable lessons, but during the scouting process, we've never seen, or I should say, we rarely see somebody who performed offensively like he did with both a field to hit and impact, power, driving the ball. At third base, you know, we thought he had the skills to stay there, whether it was, you know, good footwork, he had arm strength, just needed some coaching. And you know, when we got to know the kid and his family, that kind of sealed it for us. So that was, you know, and now that he's a good player and a regular on our team, we can say that that's a group success for us. That one, you know, I don't want to say that was an easy evaluation, but the way that he performed and the way that he carried himself made it a lot easier for us.
Mm-hmm. I know, you know, there's only so much we can say about, you know, things like bonuses and stuff like that, but it really seems like you guys have done very well with players who haven't signed for the kind of the big bonus baby type bonuses. You know, we talked about Darwin's, and Mata was what, 10, you know, Gilberto Jimenez,
25
or 25. Gilberto might've been 10 then.
Gilberto,
one of them
was
10. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Is that just a matter of, is that like we were talking about the right place, right time type deal? Is it just the efforts that you guys do to get to know these guys where they're comfortable with you? And I'm, again, it's not the negotiation piece or anything like that I'm interested in. It's just the number of guys that this happens with. And then now it seems like every year there's a guy who, oh, this guy signed for 75K and he's popping 95 and hasn't even played in the DSL yet or something. And that's where we don't even get surprised by it anymore. Is there anything to that, or is it just the product of you guys do what you do well?
I just think that, you know, again, there's so much luck and involved in all this, but having guys like Todd Klaus and Rolly Pino on the ground who are experienced evaluators, they can see some things, you know, beyond performance or beyond athleticism, you know, in terms of skill that a lot of us can't, you know. And so it's funny because in the case of Jimenez, we all saw him, and there was a push to sign him, and we were like, you know, we see this premium athlete, plus runner. He's just super raw. And, you know, he was right-handed only at the time. And it was like, then we had the opportunity again, just because we were fortunate. He hadn't been seen often, to have him come to the complex. And over a 2-week period, I remember he, you know, Jose Zapata took him under his wing. He starts working with our PD staff, and the progress, like, I remember going back in 2 weeks later and seeing the progress that he had made in 2 weeks, you know, this is where the pure athleticism kicks in. I was like, oh my God, this guy's got a chance to be good. And again, that's when we talked to the agent and everything, and we ended up signing him. You know, shows what good scouts we are. We probably should have just signed him right out of the bat. But you know, that's it. It is. It's so much of it is just being in the right place at the right time. Like Bizardo, Mata. I remember we were in Maracay, Venezuela, and Brian Mata was warming up, and there happened to be another scout in attendance, and it was starting to drizzle a little bit, and when we saw Brian Mata just warming up in the bullpen, we're like, we can't let this guy even get on the mound. So we used the rain as an excuse. We shut the workout down, and we ended up signing him that day because his parents were happened to be there in addition to his agent, you know, so, and he had been a passed over player. And our scout in that area, Alex Ricana, had been pounding the table for Brian Mata for months, but he had had a minor injury. He had kind of gotten, you know, fallen off the map. And Alex did a tremendous job in staying on him. So we don't have Brian Mata today if not for Alex Ricana staying on that, on Brian Mata.
Just quick follow up on Gilberto. You mentioned that he's obviously shown drastic improvement since he's signed, and he just constantly keeps getting better and better. What do you think the next step in his development is in order to kind of reach that potential? Which, I mean, from everything we've seen, there's a lot to like there, and it's a significant ceiling. How does he get to reaching that, you know, potential and ceiling?
Yeah, I think he's got massive upside. I think it's kind of harnessing the talent and the athleticism into gameplay, you know, realizing and working on some of the nuances, you know, how to steal a base, you know, positioning defensively, those kinds of things, recognizing, you know, like from an offensive standpoint, pitch recognition to go along with plate discipline. He's got such good hand-eye coordination. And like I said, he started switch hitting when he signed with us, and the progress that he's made is tremendous. You know, I saw him 2 weeks ago and I was like, God, his left-handed swing has come so long. He's flicking line drives in the left center field gap. And he obviously looks outstanding. You know, he's about 215 now. And, so I think that's, you know, kind of harnessing that natural talent into some of the finer things of the game, you know, base running things. Like I mentioned, stealing bags and really just refining his overall offensive approach from both sides.
Another player we wanted to ask you about, Eddie, is unfortunately someone who, you know, we don't get to talk about their development at this point. One of the biggest bonuses that the Red Sox have given out, and again, I don't care about it for the bonus, but just for context, was to catcher Daniel Flores, who unfortunately passed away before. I think he actually never got to play a game in the system, I think, right? You know, what did you guys see in him? What can you tell us about what he was like? I just want to make sure our listeners kind of get an appreciation for what the club and just, you know, kind of obviously his family and everyone too, more importantly, lost in Daniel Flores.
Sure. He was a special, you know, special person, special talent, you know, and I've actually, Haim has asked me about that too, recently, and it's tough because, you know, you run into this is such, we work in such an industry and it's so beautiful. Like, we get to meet people from all around the world and there's just certain guys that stand out, you know, and Rafi with his, you know, big smile and Moncada with his, like, you know, his personality, his larger than life personality. And obviously those guys are well known now because they're in the big leagues, but Flores was that kind of kid. You know, I remember when Rolly and Klausy went out to his family's ranch or to his agent's ranch in Venezuela, like, Daniel basically served on them. He cooked for them. He did everything, you know, like, he was extremely hospitable. And I remember just Klausy and Rolly being like, this is one of the greatest kids we've ever met. And you know, it showed through. He was a leader. And, you know, I haven't even talked about his talent yet. He was a switch hitting catcher with, he had every tool. He had power from both sides. He was a very good hitter. You know, he was, again, there's a reason why we went in as aggressively as we did. And that was a long, arduous process because we didn't think we were going to be able to get him. But again, one that I think was behind the scenes driven by Daniel in order to join us. And so, yeah, what happened was extremely tragic. That was a very, very difficult time. But he was truly such a leader already. You know, I remember when he would go to the academy as a tryout player, he used to lead guys that had been there for several months already. He was incredibly unselfish. You know, he had two mitts. This is the kind of guy he is. He had two catcher's mitts. And when he went back to Venezuela after leaving his first program with us, he knew that one of our coaches' mitts had just broken and he gave him his other mitt. So, you know, there's a lot of, you know, little stories like that about Daniel Flores. And so, anyways, we miss him. We miss the person. You know, it's just an incredibly tragic situation.
It always struck me after that happened, just the number of players, not even just the international program guys. I feel like there were U.S. guys who met him in kind of the postseason trip where, you know, some of the U.S. guys go down there who just seemed like they were really shaken up about it, if I'm remembering right, which I hope I am. But yeah, thanks for kind of sharing that with us. Ian, you want to hop in with the next one?
So because of the, as we talked about earlier, COVID kind of changed the international signing game this year. The deadline to, or the period opened only about a month ago. And you guys have obviously been pretty active out of the gate, as you mentioned earlier. Can you talk a little bit about the guys you've signed thus far? Just kind of what you see in them. Yeah. Any standouts there?
Well, sure. I'm sure everybody wants to know about Miguel Blaze. And, you know, I happened to see these guys about 2 weeks ago. Was my most recent trip down to the Dominican, and I spent a day at the complex. And I'm really, we're really excited about this class. You know, I'll start off with Miguel. You know, he's a premium center field talent. You know, he's got all five tools. He runs well. He's got an absolute hose of an arm at an early age with really good mechanics and accuracy. So we think that he's, you know, he can stay in the middle of the field. He's got surprising power, you know, being so young and being able to have above average raw power was something that we obviously, we don't see often for a center field player, given his body type and athleticism. And so really what we need to hone in on with him is his approach. You know, he performed well offensively in competition for us, and he's continued to do that, you know, in the academy. So he's a high character kid that is all about baseball, and he's from San Pedro. Obviously, there is, you know, the baseball player. They put something in the water there to create baseball players, and so we hope that he can kind of continue that lineage of talent coming out of that area. He's extremely exciting. We signed three players out of Curaçao this year. Our scout Dennis Newman there did a hell of a job. And we signed a pitcher there who's a monster. He's 6'4". His name's Yisrael Burnett. And, you know, he's a lower slot, tough slot guy. He was, you know, mid-80s when we started, and then he started creeping up into, you know, the upper 80s. He's athletic. He moves his feet really well for a big guy. And he's another one that, you know, we're excited about getting him in the fold. A couple of Venezuelan guys. Anderson Lira is a big catcher. You know, I think one of our cross checkers put like a Sandy Alomar frame comp on him, which I thought was really good. He's, you know, 6'1", 185-ish, and just strong, like country strong, huge hands, really good receiving, really strong arm, and another guy with raw power that we're excited to get. Abraham Liendo, he's a smaller framed middle infielder, super twitchy and athletic. Has a 70 raw arm strength right now. It's one of the best infield arms that we've scouted, you know, in a player signing class. And, you know, we have him at short now. He could probably play all three infield positions if necessary, second, short, and third. And, again, switch hitter, line drive approach. But he's exciting. He's another little gamer too. Trying to think if there's anybody else. On the pitching side, Alvaro Mejias, you know, you guys have, I know he's a social media famous. He came in strong. Again, with the pitchers, it's such a toss up. We just, you know, look for how the delivery works and how the ball comes out of the hand and their athleticism. And he checks all those boxes. So again, we don't exactly know when we're going to be able to have those guys in a competitive environment outside of inter squads, but you know, hopefully we can ensure that there's a DSL this year and see some of these guys in action.
Yeah, I guess let me hop in because I know we only have you for so much longer, and I love just winding you up and letting you go on these guys because I learn so much about the players and the system. But as far as having a DSL this year, does it seem like that there would be any impediment to that, or does it look like it's probably a full go as far as you know?
We're actively discussing that with MLB right now. You know, everybody hopes that there is. It's just all, you know, pandemic affected, and so. You know, we're still working on the best way to organize that, how what the structure would be, how the testing would go. And so, you know, we really want to have another forum, a platform for these guys to develop after so many of them missed the entire season last year. So fortunately, we opened up on January 15th this year. We have roughly 48 players there now. And, a good number of those guys will report to minor league spring training once the big league club leaves Fort Myers here. And then we can, kind of backfill with the players that we haven't seen in a while and get those guys into the academy to kind of reignite their development, which has been on hold for so long. So, that's kind of the plan. But, we really hope that we can have a DSL. If not, at the very least, they'll stay at the academy. And we'll continue to develop them, under Zapata's guidance as well as we can.
If there is a DSL, are the guys who signed back in January eligible to play? Because obviously in a normal season, they're not. We talked about earlier, but would they be able to since the changed dates?
Yes, I think they would be. I think we're pushing for that to be. There could be some roster crunching that will be necessary, but
sure.
We'll cross that bridge when we get to it. But like the Blazes and the Liras of the world, those guys were set to sign last July 2nd so that they would have been eligible to play this year. So mm-hmm. Our hope is that they will be able to play. And, we have, when you combine that class with some of the guys from last year, we like what we have out there on those two teams.
Okay. And then I guess just to our last kind of wind you up and let you go sort of question, or I guess it's one question, just with the current crop of guys that are, I guess when we wrote this question, I was thinking more of the guys who will be stateside this year, but the current crop of younger international signees, whether it's the guys who will be in whatever the heck the complex league winds up being this year, or even maybe going to, make sure I get this right, Salem, who are some of the guys that stand out there that, we've seen some of them that get some pub? Obviously everyone knows about Herberto and we've talked about him, but there's some that are maybe not quite as known. Any real standouts there that you think our listeners and folks who read the website should really be keeping an eye on in 2021 and going forward?
Sure. Well, Brainer Bonacy is somebody who's kind of no stranger to you guys and deservedly so. He's really put himself on the map, and he's a shortstop, and he'll stay there and out of Venezuela. And he's somebody that's, got really intriguing upside. He's a switch hitter with power from both sides, and he's not tall. He's strong. He's not tall. But that doesn't, that doesn't hold him back. He's put on some good weight this off season, and he put together a really strong performance in instructional league. Obviously somebody that we're excited about, and I think somebody that, you've started to see on the prospect list and everything, and he's deserved that. He's worked his tail off to get to that point. There's a couple other guys, Sidon Rafaela is a really athletic, twitchy kid who can play all over the field. He can play all infield positions. Down in the Dominican right now, he's working in center field also. Good bat-to-ball skills with surprising power for a skinny guy, and he's working on getting a little bit stronger. He's another one of these players who just always seems to be in the right spot, no matter the position, where it's, on cutoffs and relays or what bunt plays, wherever he's very heady, very smart. He's played a lot of baseball in Curacao. A couple pitchers, like Aldo Ramirez and Jorge Rodriguez, two guys out of Mexico. I mentioned them. Mm-hmm. Aldo has kind of really popped on the scene, mid-90s fastball with a really, really good changeup, and he's really working hard on the breaking ball and on the cutter. That's coming along. Jorge Rodriguez is probably the savviest pitcher that we have. We call him the savvy Mexican. Really, really good breaking ball, really good changeup, and he really can really spot his fastball. His fastball sits low 90s, but he's a competitor and really, really knows how to pitch. Outside of those guys, we still don't know exactly where Liu's going to start up or Chi Young Liu's going to start up. We just need to see him. He was in spring training for a couple weeks last year before we had to shut down. And then the pandemic hit, obviously, and then we had him in for instructional league for a little bit. But he's somebody that we just need to, lay our eyes on some more and get him familiar with our programs. But he's another talent that we're super excited about and a big upside. When he was when he was on in Taiwan, you know, it was upper 90s with wipeout slider and really good athleticism, him being a former position player. And I'm just another guy that we throw him into the mix, and hopefully he can stand out this year.
All right. Well, I know we've got to let you go soon, Eddie. I'll let you go, not soon, because you've got another appointment you've got to make. But as always, we appreciate you coming on. We appreciate talking to you. You've been great to us. I think you were probably one of the first front office guys we really got to know out on the backfields and stuff like that. And we've always appreciated that. And we appreciate you taking the time today. And it's been certainly a busy time. We joked on email that I definitely should have done this over the summer when nothing else was going on, and that's my bad. But hey, you know, it is what it is, and we're pumped to have you on. Hopefully it won't be, you know, 203 episodes before we have you on again to talk with you about some more of the guys that were getting into the system. So we appreciate it, man.
Oh, thanks for having me. Thanks for the work that you guys do. You know, hey, we're all avid followers of you guys, and just keep doing what you're doing, and appreciate you having me on.
All right. Thanks so much, Eddie. We appreciate it, man.
All right, guys.